Good morning students, hope you are all fine and safe. So in this video we will learn the last but the important poem for the second year English. Actually it is a poem number 5, poem number 5, but for this year we need to learn only 4. We have already completed 3 poems so far under the section of poetry. The first one is The Tables Turned by William Wordsworth, and the second one is The Builders by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, and the third one is Any Woman by Catherine Tynan, and the last poem is A Challenge to Fate by our Nightingale of India, the great writer Sarojini Naidu. Sarojini Naidu. So this is the last one from the section of poetry that we are going to learn. So as we are doing usually when we learn a lesson, that is the regular activities, learn about the poet, to know the biography of the poet in a brief manner. So let us discuss the first point. Sarojini Naidu, the Nightingale of India, was born on February 13, 1879 in Hyderabad. Now it is in Telangana. Before that, it was in Andhra Pradesh, as we are all know. So she was born in Hyderabad, in our Telugu state. Particularly, we can expect a question or an annotation. In the last year question paper, I mean the question paper what that was written by your senior students, that was given in the March 2020 public intermediate public examination, an annotation was given from this particular poem as it was written by an Indian writer. The first 3 poems were written by foreigners, and here is the one and only author who belongs to India, that is Mrs. Sarojini Naidu. So she was born, where she was born? She was born in Hyderabad. In which year? On February 13, 1879. If you want to know about her parents, her father was the founder of Nizam College, and her mother was a famous Bengali poetess. Famous Bengali poetess. So we can understand she came from a well-educated background. She came from a well-educated background. So that is the influence also. The family background influence also shows on her. Her father wanted her to become a scientist, or scientist regarding the subject of mathematics, but she had an interest on the poetry from her tender age. Tender age means from very young age. So that is what regarding her family. Her father was an educationist and a philanthropist who contributed, who donated much, and who donated land for the Nizam College, that was one of the famous colleges in Hyderabad, located in Telangana state. So that was her family background. And let us see the second thing also. She was a child prodigy. She was a child prodigy. So prodigy in the sense here, a wonder kid, that means who did great things, who gives outputs older than her age, beyond her age. We generally see some children does the things what elder can say in their language. So such kids are considered as prodigies or wonder kids. And she was a freedom fighter. She participated in the struggle of independence. She worked along with her father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhiji. And woman leader, she was also a woman leader. When we take the woman leader, she worked as a first governor for the province of UP. She was the first governor of the UP. Here, the short forms UP stands for not Uttar Pradesh. Now, of course, it is called as Uttar Pradesh. Then, after the independence, 1947 or 1948, in that duration, it was considered as United Province. But now it is considered as, it has now considered as a state, as Uttar Pradesh. So we need to remember that she was the first governor of UP. Here the UP, the short form UP stands for United Province. Why? Until 1950, India didn't become a republic state. India became a republic state. That's why they considered it as a province. So woman leader, she inspired so many women and encouraged so many women. She was being a model to many Indian women to participate, to take a part in Indian freedom movement. And she was a skilled orator. So orator means a speaker. Speaker in the sense is not the person who officially sit in the assembly and enjoy the powers of controlling the members of a formal parliament or members of an assembly. Legislative counselor, like that. But through her speeches, she inspired many women particularly. That's why she was a woman leader, an exemplary administrator. Here, exemplary, the word exemplary indicates a role model. She was an inspiration. She was an inspiration to many women. Because from the very young age, she has shown her talent. Since her engaged by writing a poetry or by participating in the freedom movement, all these things. So because of the work, because of her poems, she was given the sobriquet. Observe the spelling of sobriquet. It is not sobriquet. No, the T is silent here. Sobriquet means nickname. It was a nickname. The title, the Nightingale of India, is a sobriquet given by Mahatma Gandhi to our poet Sarojini Naidu, based on her poems particularly. Because as her poems were lyrical and rich in imagery, Mahatma Gandhi has given this nickname. And also, she was also called as Bharata Kokila. And this is the title given by great writer Rabindranath Tagore, Viswakavi Rabindranath Tagore. So we can understand, so many of the freedom fighters fond of Sarojini Naidu and her work. Okay, let us see. She was a polyglot. Here the word polyglot means a person who has proficiency in speaking or writing in many languages, particularly more than two languages. More than two languages. If you take an example, our former Prime Minister of India, Mr. P.V. Narasimha Rao, was a polyglot. She can speak nine languages. He can speak nine languages. And like that, she has proficiency in, see, Bengali, as her mother was a famous Bengali poetess, Urdu and Telugu. These two languages are generally spoken in Telangana state, as there are many Muslims lives in that state, particularly in Hyderabad. And she also knew English and Persian. So how many languages she can speak? Bengali, Urdu, Telugu, English and Persian, five languages. So that's why she was called as polyglot. I'm saying you need to remember these kind of words. Why? Because in the grammar section we have a topic of vocabulary. In the first year we just read 17 matchings as the synonyms, especially that are given after every lesson. But here, in this year, the same words will be given, but it is in a different format. How? The words that will be given in this year as referred as one word substitutions. So one word substitutions are like this. Polyglot is one among them. So here the root word poly indicates multi or many. Basing on root word, we can remember more and more words. So like that. Next, see the next poem, next sentence. Her poems were lyrical. So lyrical in the sense, we can study them and understand them easily, and they are convenient to sing like a song. Those poems are convenient to sing like a song, which is flawed with simple words. And rich in imagery. Here imagery in the sense, Sarojini Naidu presents beautiful picture of locality, because most of the poems based on Indian Mulu means background. She took so many things that we see regularly in our society. She took it. For example, take the poem which was written by her is Bangle Sellers. In this beautiful poem, she described how a bangle sellers sells bangles and the different colors they are made of. And these are the things she put in her poems beautifully. So bangles we generally see with the hands of our women. It is our culture. Particularly we generally see wearing bangles in India. And such kinds of subjects are presented in a beautiful manner through her poems. So imagine it in the sense, We can imagine the colorful pictures while reading her poems. So such a richness her poems got. So this is about the, or rather, and there is one thing. She was worked as a president for Indian National Congress also. She worked as a president for the Indian National Congress, the party. It is not a party, actually it was an organization that works for independence. That works for independence. So because of her talent, she got many respectable positions in India. So this is about, and let us see her famous work. Who brought her to limelight? That one is Golden Threshold. It's a volume of poems, collection of poems, Golden Threshold. The second one is The Bird of Time, and the third one is The Bazaars in Hyderabad. So these are the three important poems. Of course, she has written many poems like what I mentioned now, Palanquin Bearers, Bangle Sellers. These are also very beautiful poems. We generally see one of these poems in your school syllabus. So these are the poems written by her. Let us see what she has written in our present poem. Before going to discuss, before going to have an idea on the poem, let me explain what is the meaning of the title of the poem. So take the first one. What is the title of our poem? Is A Challenge to Fate. The word challenge we generally use when we call a person to compete with us. When we call a person to compete with us, this is just like a competition. So here, he calls someone, he challenges someone. Whom he is challenging? He is challenging a fate. Fate is nothing but destiny. Fate is nothing but destiny. Here, the word destiny means not the distance. We generally refer the destination, the ending place. If you travel from one place to another, the second place where you want to reach is called destination or destiny. But here, the destiny has separate meaning. The fate is referred as destiny. Here, there is a complete definition of destiny. It is a predetermined event, course of events, which are out of control of a person. It's a philosophical definition. A predetermined course of events which are out of the control of a person. So we can simply understand our destiny or our fate is not in our hands. It generally comes as an output of our past actions. We can say philosophically as karma. So destiny is also referred as karma. As Vivekananda said in our second essay, The Secret of Work, the impressions of our good and bad activities or bad deeds. So we can understand a fate is a predetermined course of events which are out of the control of a person, because we can't control. Generally, people scare of fate, scare of destiny. If something is happened negatively, we just cause it as a fate. We just cause it as our fate. If you fail in something, if you are unable to fulfill something, if you are unable to achieve a goal, we just apply it. It is our fate. We just consider it as our fate or destiny. We just think that I have done a lot of mistakes, a lot of blunders in my previous birth. That's why, because of that result, now the things are happening in this way. We just think in that manner. That is what called fate or destiny. We generally believe. Many people believe. So here, an inanimate object is not, it is not an object. Fate is an abstract thing, I'm saying. Fate is an abstract thing, which has no life, which has no sense. so which have no taste at all. So as we learned, the kinds of nouns, there are abstract nouns, isn't it? While we learn in parts of speech. So here, fate is an abstract thing. Here, the writer challenges fate. So let us see what she is going to tell. A challenge to fate is a beautiful, inspiring poem. Okay, obviously it is a beautiful poem because as it was written by our great writer Sarojini Naidu, because her poems were rich in language and rich in imagery. So no doubt at all. And inspiring poem. Through this poem, she inspires us in a different way. How? Let us see. The poem depicting the strong spirit of human soul. The strong spirit of human soul. Here it inspires us. Everyone should have a determined willpower to face the struggles, to face the fear, to face the difficulties that will happen while achieving a goal. So that is advice she is going to give through her poem. And see the second thing. She shows how an enlightened human spirit, enlightened means full of knowledge, full of awareness. Human spirit cannot be defeated by fate. A person who is strongly determined, who has a strong mind, is strong in the sense, not in a physical way. We should be strong in a mentally. So mentally means in our thinking process. We should be strong in taking decisions, in facing troubles. So that is what she presents in her poem. A human spirit cannot be defeated by fate. Here, don't understand the spirit is nothing but a ghost or something else. No, he is talking about the spirit in us. Of course, it is also an abstract thing. It is a belief. And in this poem, the poet refuses to submit herself. In this poem, the poet refuses to submit herself. She don't want to surrender. She don't want to surrender to the fate. As I said, afraid of fate. They just, generally fate scares us. That means we believe that something bad will happen. Something bad will happen. So here she don't want the fate to take over her, to dominate her. She want to fight with this. However compelling it is. So we will see how fate will manipulate by giving troubles and worries to human life or human beings. So let us see how he faces it. So these are the main points in a brief manner in the poem Challenge to Fate, written by our great politician, orator, a versatile genius, we can say, a versatile genius, Sarojini Naidu. So now let us go through the stanzas. The poem consists of six stanzas. So let us deal with that. Let us learn line by line in detail. And open your textbook and see the lines. Right? Come. Okay. Let us see the stanzas in detail. Before going that, I am showing you the title of the lesson in the textbook, A Challenge to Fate by Sarojini Naidu. Hope you are seeing this. Yes, we will start the poem. I am just making it visible to you by expanding. And see the first stanza. So before going into the poem in detail, before going to learn the poem in detail, let me say you, the meaning of the fate is destiny. One's destiny, and the definition is, it's a predetermined events, a course of predetermined events that is not in the control of a person. And some people believe it as karma. Some people believe it as karma. And some people, the concept is bogus. So whatever may be, here we need to learn what are the poet writes here. I am going to read out the first stanza for you. Let us see. Why will you vex me with your futile conflict? Why will you vex me with your futile conflict? And why will you strive with me, oh foolish fate? You cannot break me with your poignant envy. You cannot slay me with your subtle hate. For the cruel folly you pursue, I will not cry with suppliant hands to you. So in the first stanza, the poet challenges the fate. The poet questions the fate. Why? The fate is not allowing the poet to be happy. So here, the fate tries to make our poetess unhappy. It is making futile attempts. It is making attempts to make the poet unhappy. So see, you can underline the first word, vex. So vex means annoy, make someone angry. Here, Sarojini Naidu asked the fate, why you are annoying me? Why you are making angry? So by what he is making angry? By what the fate is making angry? By attempting to make her unhappy, by make her sad. But here the poetess says, the conflict, here the word conflict means struggle, a fight that goes on for a long time, and we can say a conflict is a long battle or long fight with an enemy. Here the poet treats fate as her enemy. That's why she is asking, why you are making futile attempts? So you can understand the meaning of the word futile means useless, purposeless, without any purpose. Without any purpose, the fate is trying to make her unhappy. Here, we do not take the meaning fate is as a person. Of course, it is a personification. She is treating fate as a person. It is called personification in English literature. So personification, the figure of speech, means when we consider an inanimated object, inanimated means an object that is lifeless. An abstract thing. Here, the feeling of fate is an abstract thing. We cannot see directly. We cannot see it physically with our eyes. So that's why it is called personification. Of course, whatever it may be, here the poetess treat fate as a person. That's why she imagines and asks, why you are making futile attempts, that is purposeless, that is useless. Why will you strive with me? Here you can write the meaning for the word strive. Strive means making great efforts to achieve a goal. Here, who is trying to make great efforts? The fate is trying to make great efforts to make our poetess unhappy, feel sad. So that's why she is asking, she is calling the fate as foolish. Oh, foolish fate. So there is a question mark, interrogative mark is given at the end of the line, oh, foolish fate. Here, the poetess Sarojini Naidu calls the fate as foolish because it is making a futile attempt, purposeless attempts. You cannot break me with your poignant envy, with your poignant envy. Break me means destroy me or make a harm. So you cannot harm me with your poignant. So poignant means a feeling or a desire that one wants to make someone unhappy or make someone sad with your envy, with the feeling of envy. So envy means jealous. Envy means jealous. Oh my dear fate, with your jealous, you can't break me. You cannot destroy me. You cannot slay me with your subtle hate. Here he is continuing the same question. You cannot slay me. Slay means cut a person's body with a knife. Cut a body with someone's with knife. Cut a someone's body with a knife by using a blade or a sword. So that is what the action, what that is what the word means. Slay me with your subtle hate. So we can take it the meaning as giving pain. Giving pain. Physical pain. So you cannot slay me with your subtle hate. Here, underline the word subtle. That means unnoticeable. Subtle means unnoticeable. So with the feeling of hatred, you cannot slay me. You cannot slay me. You cannot break me. You cannot make me painful. You cannot give me pain. For all the cruel folly you pursue, I will not cry with suppliant hands to you. Here, the poetess says, she will not allow the fate, she will not allow the fate to make her unhappy. That means he finally says that the poetess will not surrender, will not submit herself to the fate. Whatever the plans, whatever the cruel plans to make the poetess unhappy. She is a strong-minded fellow and she is a determined fellow. Her determination is very strong. So what determination she has? She don't want to submit herself to the fate. Here you can understand the meaning of suppliant hands. Here you can write the meaning of the word. Suppliant hand means begging, pleading, making an utmost request. So whatever you do, whatever the plan you make, you try to make me unhappy, I won't surrender. I will not allow you to make me unhappy. So in this way, the poetess challenges the fate. In this way, the poetess challenges the fate. Here, there is an important thing, that is you can underline the last two lines as a first annotation. For all the cruel folly you pursue, I will not cry with suppliant hands to you. And these are the two lines that are given as first annotation. So let's go to second stanza. See, you may perchance reckon your better malice. Here also the same meaning. Malice means to make a cruel plan to harm someone. Plotting. Here we can understand malice means plotting. You may perchance reckon. Here the phrase reckon means destroy. You may perchance, if you have a chance to destroy. द रेडियंट एम्पायर ऑफ माइंड ईगर आइस. यू मे ट्राई टू डिस्ट्रॉय माय एम्पायर. हियर शी सेज द फेट इज ट्राइंग टू डिस्ट्रॉय हर एम्पायर. हियर एम्पायर इन द सेंस शी इज नॉट ए क्वीन और ए किंग टू sit or enjoy. Empire means her memories, her thoughts, her life, we can say. So the radiant, here you can write the meaning of the word radiant, that is permanent. Empire of mind, eager eyes, with your eager eyes. Eager eyes means scare or with the fear of death, with the fear of death, because people believe that because of fate, some may die very early. But here, the poetess is not afraid of death. That means not afraid of fate. And she is continuing, say, can you rob my memories, dear Dominion? That means, with your plans, you may destroy me physically. You may give pain to me, but you cannot rob. Rob means steal. Take someone's things or articles without their permission. The action is called robbing or stealing also. And you cannot rob my memories, dear Dominion. In the first stanza, she daringly calls the fate as foolish. But in this stanza, she calls her Dominion. So Dominion means an officer with full of powers, an authoritative, a superior authoritative. So my dear superior authoritative, the fate, you cannot rob my memories that has already been stored in my mind. You may physically hit on my mind, but you cannot wipe out the memories I have stored in my mind. Over sunlit mountains and sidereal skies. So what are the memories she had? She is explaining here. Over sunlit mountains and sidereal skies, in my enduring treasuries I hold. Over sunlit mountains and sidereal skies means you can't rob my memories by running over sunlit mountains, the mountains that are shining because of the light of the sun, and sidereal skies, in the sky. Here sidereal sky means the sky that is studded with stars, sky full of stars, over the mountains or in the sky. You can't take my memories. You are unable to take my them because I have stored in my mind as a treasure. See, in my enduring treasures I hold. In my enduring, you can understand the word enduring means permanent. Treasuries I hold. So here she treats the memories as a treasure, their ageless splendor. Those memories will not fade away. They are ageless. The splendor, the beauty of those memories will not fade away like unravished gold. So unravished means violate the chastity, the purity of gold. The purity of the gold. That is the meaning she is giving through the second stanza. And let us see the third one. You may azap. It's not azrap. Azap. R is silent here. You may azap. Azap means, you can write, take someone's position without their permission. And in simple manner, take control of someone, take over the kingdoms of my hearing. He comes to the sensory powers. The first one is hearing power. Hearing power. So you may usurp the kingdoms of my hearing. You may take away. You may make me deaf. If someone is not able to hear the sounds around us, we can call it, we can call him as a dumb. So like that, if the fate make her unable to hear, say, shall my scandalous spirit, scandalous means harmless, scandalous means harmless. A soul that doesn't want to do any harm to others, cease to hear. Cease means stop. Cease means stop to hear. You may physically make me deaf, but I can hear the beautiful sound. I can listen to the music of the nature through my heart. Through my heart. That is what she is saying here. And see the third line, the bridal rapture of the blowing valleys, the lyric pageant of the passing year. So here she is explaining the beauty of the nature, because she is also a nature lover. She tries to present the beauty of nature through her poems, as we discussed in the introduction, while we learning about the poem, about the poet also. I told you her poems are lyrical and rich in imagery. So here she is showing her talent. The bridal rapture of the blowing valleys, the lyric pageant of the passing year. Here the word pageant means an entertainment, a concert, a musical program. And we can understand here the sounds we can hear through the beautiful sound we can hear in the valleys by blowing the wind. The sounding words and singing harmonies. Here she uses another word, words. A word is a lyrical poem. A word is a lyrical poem that we generally see in poetry. And singing harmonies. So harmonies means playing different types of musical instruments at a time, in a beautiful manner, not in a harsh manner. So of battling tempests and unconquered seas. So in the above two lines, she presents the beautiful sounds that we generally hear in the nature. Blowing wind, sounding of words, and singing harmonies. In the last line, she said, of battling tempests. Here, tempest means a strong, violent wind, we can call it as a strong. And unconquered seas. And these are the harsh or loud sounds. Generally, wind will be harsh. Wind is very harsh during storms. And while we traveling, on a boat on the sea, it hears loud. So these are the harsh sounds. So we can hear sweet sound and the harsh sounds that are created by the nature. That we generally have in nature. So through this stanza, the writer, the poetess, tries to give the meaning of, though fate takes away her power of listening, she can hear and enjoy the music of nature, and different sounds she can perceive, she can hear. That are pageant, sounding words, singing harmonies, battling tempests, and unconquered seas. These are all the sounds made by wind, simply we can say. We hear through wind. So she can enjoy the music through her heart. That is what she is saying. And let's see the next stanza. Yeah, you may smite my mouth to the throbbing silence, pluck from my lips power of articulate words. Say, shall my heart lack its familiar language? So only three lines are here, because the stanza is continuing in the next page. See it? Is it visible? Okay. While earth has nests for her mellifluous birds, shall my impassioned heart forget to sing when the 10,000 voices of spring. I'm reading it again. See, you may smite. Smite means hit very hard. My mouth to throbbing silence, that means you may take away my power of speaking. It's talking about the second sense. We have five senses generally: touch, taste, smell, listen. So these are all the senses we have, and she is talking about the important sense we have is speaking. You may smite my mouth to throbbing silence. Here the fate may take away, unable to make her speak. We can understand, if the fate make her dumb. In the previous stanza, she asked, if you make me deaf. Comes to the next disability, next sensory power, that is speaking. If you make me as a dumb fellow, pluck from my lips power of articulate words. You may make me dumb by not speaking any words. If you do not allow me speaking my articulate my words, if you make me dumb, say, shall my heart lack its familiar language? Though you make me dumb, my heart has a language. My heart has a familiar language. It can understand many things. How beautifully she is saying here. Let's see the continuing. While earth has nests for her mellifluous birds, as earth has alternatives. Earth is providing nests. Earth allows birds to build nests. Earth has nests for mellifluous birds, as the earth providing place to settle, providing place for birds to settle. Here she calls the birds as mellifluous. Mellifluous means a bird that sings beautifully. So as an earth has its alternative to safeguard its creatures, like that my heart also has a familiar language to understand, though you make me dumb. That is the meaning we take here. Shall my impassioned heart forget to sing? No, you can't do it. What? The fate can't do it with the poetess. The fate cannot make her to forget to sing. She can sing through her heart, not by her mouth, because the fate may take away the sense of speaking, right? And let's move on to the last one. With the 10,000 voices of the spring, how her voice will be? It is equal to 10,000 voices of the spring. Why the poetess points out spring? It is a name of a season. It is a name of a season. It generally appears before summer, in the months of March and April. During this period, nature looks beautiful by blooming flowers, and fruits. Nature looks in a greenery, in green, in full in green. And we can generally hear the beautiful sounds made by cuckoo in our area, in our region, that means India. But here, generally the word spring is used with the British writers. Okay, we can call it Vasanta Kalam. Right? So let's move on to the next stanza. I'm showing it on the screen. Just, yeah, you may quell. Quell means squash, perish. You may finish also. You may quell my blood with sudden anguish. You may stop, you may crush my veins, blood veins, with a sudden anguish. Anguish means severe mental pain, severe mental torture, we can say. Fetter my limbs, fetter means arrest. Tie with a rope or a chain. Limbs means the hands and legs, with someone compelling pain. So you may give me a severe pain by tying my limbs, tying my hands and legs, by tying very tightly, and stop my blood veins by giving a sudden anguish. How will you don my free far journeying fancy that rides upon the pinions of the rain? So underline the lines. How will you don my free far journeying fancy that rides upon the pinions of the rain? Underline the two lines in the middle, because this is an important annotation that has already been given this year question paper. That means the question paper that was written by your seniors. So very important one. And this is an annotation. How will you daunt my free? How will you stop? How will you control my free far journey? So without any hesitation, my fancies, my dreams will travel. On which vehicle, by which vehicle it is traveling, the soul of our poet is traveling? By using the pinions of the rain. Here, she compares the rain as a bird with wings. Pinions means wings. Here, she compares the rain as a bird. She personifies a bird with wings. She personifies the rain as a bird with wings. So on the winged bird, she travels. She makes her soul travel. How will you tether my triumphant mind? How can you arrest? Tether means tie with a rope. Underline the word tether and write the meaning in your notes. Tether means arrest. That means tie a rope around something. My triumphant mind. My mind has already won over your plans. That's why she has been telling that the attempts what are made by the fate will be purposeless and also useless. Rival and fearless comrade of the wind. How the soul of the poets will journey? Rival. It's a competitor to the fate and fearless. So from the beginning of the poem, she says that it's a comrade friend. So my soul is the friend of wind. My comrade wind supports me to fly in the sky like a bird. So we can finally say she can fly in the sky. She compares herself as a bird with wings. Birds with the wings very freely. Who supports her to fly in the sky? The wind. Because she feels the wind as her comrade. Comrade means her friend. So thus She challenges the fate, though the fate gives her, stop her blood veins to run. Her soul can travel in the nature, right? Let's see the next stanza. Though, the last one, though you deny the hope of all my being, betray my love, my sweetest dream destroy, yet will I slake my individual sorrow at the deep source of universal joy? O fate, in vain you hanker to control my frail, serene, indomitable soul. So see the first word in the first line, T-H-O with apostrophe. That means it is a short form of though, generally used in Old English. T-H-O-U-G-H, though. You can understand though. Though you deny. Deny means reject. The hope of all my being, though you may break my hope, try to break my hope, betray my love, cheat. Betray means cheating with your plans. My sweetest dream destroy, yet will I slake my individual sorrow at the deep source of universal joy? Though you break my hope in living, you can't break my happiness. Though you break my hope, but you cannot break my, you cannot spoil my joy. Here, what kind of joy she is experiencing? Universal joy. So she is living with universal joy. She doesn't care the fate. She doesn't look at the fate, the consequence that will be happen regarding because of fate. So she is having the hope of elixir. Elixir in the sense, a cure for all diseases. A cure for all diseases. It is permanent. Generally, people believe elixir gives permanent life. That means the person will become immortal. It's a liquid made by idols, the goddesses in the heaven. So that is called elixir. So such kind of elixir, she is compared the hope she has to elixir. With that hope, she is living with universal joy. So we can understand, by being happy, we can come over, we can control over ourselves. By being happy, you cannot think of the fate. You can win over the fate. You can win over the fate by being happy, by enjoying universal joy, not a pleasure. Right? Oh fate, in vain means useless, futile attempt. You hanker to control. You may not control, you will not control, you cannot control my frail means weak, serene, silent, indomitable, unable to conquer. Indomitable means unable to conquer. So my dear fate, you cannot conquer my soul. Though you physically, you may give pain physically, you may take away my senses, like hearing, sense of hearing, sense of speaking. You may crush my blood veins, but I may live very happily because I am not afraid of you. I am not scared. I doesn't care of your fate. So thus the poet completes her advice. So as we said, it is an inspirational poem. So what the poem inspires, how the poem inspires us by saying this, we can take it in a positive manner. Though in spite of difficulties, In spite of difficulties, we should be happy. Because, for example, if you want to achieve something, while achieving something, you may face a lot of obstacles, lot of difficulties that may encounter, that you may encounter while achieving a goal. But don't stop. Go on. How can we continue our efforts to achieve our goal? By being happy, by being confident. Here, take fate as the obstacle. It makes you stop. It gives so much of struggles. It creates so many problems in your life. So life is a journey. We may face so many things while we reach our destination. In reaching our destination. But don't stop your journey. How can we do that thing? By being positive, by being confident, by having a willpower, by having a strong determination. So this is what Sarojini Naidu gives us as an advice. So we can control over fate by being fearless, by being determined, Thus we can win over our problems, like what Sarojini Naidu says through his poem. So you can understand, you can see the annotations. I'm saying you again, the first annotation is given in the first stanza. For all the cruel folly you pursue, I will not cry with suppliant hands. I'm showing you, see, this is the glossary I have already told you. And see the annotations here. See, for all the cruel you folly you pursue, I will not cry with suppliant hands to you. And see the answer. You can prepare this answer directly, because the textbook answer is the best one than the given in the material. So here is a doubt. A doubt will arise to you. The answer begins with the context, but don't worry. You can write as it is, or if you want to make it, you can divide into two paragraphs as we generally do, by begin with the subheading reference. So with reference, these lines are taken from the poem A Challenge to Fate by Sarojini Naidu. In this poem, the poet refuses to submit herself to fate, however compelling it is. It is the reference. And thus she can stands as an exemplary figure to all those who curse their fate and submit themselves to it. You can put them as context. And you can write the other two subheadings. The poet questions fate as to why it does not hollow, as an explanation, and general elements. And see the next, second annotation is given here. You may smite my mouth to throbbing silence. It is given in the stanza number 5. In the stanza number 5, it is given. The first annotation is given in the first stanza. The second annotation is given in the fourth one. And see the third one. How will you daunt my free far journeying fancy that rides upon the pinions of the rain? It is given in the fifth stanza, stanza number 5, the middle two lines, and the last stanza. Yet will I slake my individual sorrow. It is given in the last stanza, stanza number 6, the last two lines. Got it? So these are the annotations given in the poem, A Challenge to Fate. So hope you understand well in the poem. So you can read the answer of the first annotation again. I will provide you the notes when you get this video through the YouTube link. The notes will be provided to you through the WhatsApp group. I will provide you two kinds of answers as we regularly do, as we did in the first year. I will provide the lengthy answers for the bright students, and I will provide you a single answer. Single answer means, as you are all know, that answer for all questions and answer for all annotation. For the students who are unable to study the answers for every question or every annotation, right? So be prepared well. We can expect an annotation or a question. Sometimes both will give an annotation or a question from this poem, because why I am saying this is, it is written by Indian poet Sarojini Naidu. That is the reason. So hope you understand well, and hope you enjoy the class. Thank you so much for